worship today as we gather on the 26th Sunday after Pentecost. This is the Reign of Christ Sunday. Often we think of it as Christ the King Sunday as well. But today in Ezekiel's reading of the scripture, we receive a new definition for what it means to be a king. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Join with me in the words from the psalm for this day. Had it not been the Lord on our side, that the people now say, then they would have swallowed us up alive, and the flood would have swept us away. Blessed be the Lord who rescues us and gives us life.
We have escaped like a bird from the snare of the powers. The snare is broken, and we have escaped.
Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth.
Let us rejoice in our deliverance and praise the Lord.
Spirit may undergird them. We lift them up and come. So there you have it, fancy and energetic. So it was that last week's reading of Scripture was the epistle assigned for the day. You may remember it if I remind you, if I remind myself from 1 Thessalonians. It was a word of encouragement. Today's reading is the Old Testament reading assigned for this day. As an invitation to you to consider that good news comes from all portions of the Bible, not just what we call the Gospels, the good news of Jesus Christ. That good news is spoken and proclaimed throughout the biblical witness. There are two sets of words, as you see in your worship bulletin, reading from Ezekiel chapter 34, verses 11 through 16, skipping four verses, and then going to verses 20 through 24. The first portion is about what God does. The second portion is about what people do and what God does to fix what people do. May you receive a word of hope for everything that you have messed up in life, or decisions you are now not happy about, or regrets that you carry. This proclamation is about a God who fixes things, who reclaims and redeems. And it's a sign of God's enormous love for us, in spite of, despite who we are and what we do. So if that's not good news to you, I don't know what is, because it's very good news to me. For this is what the Sovereign Lord says, I myself will search for my sheep and look after them. As a shepherd looks after the flock scattered, when the shepherd is with them, so I will look for my sheep, and I will find them. I will rescue them from all the places where they were scattered on a day of darkness and clouds. I will bring them out from the nations and gather them from the countries. Now you realize this is talking about exiles. This is talking about the Israelites as refugees in foreign lands who've been scattered, and God's going to gather them in from the countries. And I will bring them back into their own land. And I will pasture them, because that's what a shepherd does. I will pasture them on the mountains of Israel and in the ravines. That stands out to me. The hills and the ravines and in all the settlements in the land. I will tend them in a good pasture. This reading of Scripture does not stop with just one descriptor limited to one sentence. It says over and again the same type of thing. I will tend to them. I will bring them. I will pasture them. I will tend them in a good pasture. And the mountain heights of Israel, even the mountain heights, even the rough places, even the barren places, will be their grazing land. God's abundance everywhere. It is there in those places, in these places, that they will lie down in good grazing land. And there they will feed in a rich pasture, rich, good, abundant, the highs and the lows. God's pasture is all. Let us always be looking for God's green pastures wherever we are, in whatever circumstances of life. God wants us in green pastures. I myself will tend my sheep, and I will have them lie down. Isn't that good news? We don't even have to lie down on our own. God helps us to lay down. And hopefully God helps us to get up. Let me hear an amen on that. Because we need help getting up. Right? And I will even search for the lost and bring back the strays. Maybe that's all of us at some point in time. Maybe multiple times. That we're the ones who become lost and we're the ones that become strayed. I will bind up the injured. I will strengthen the weak. See, God doesn't stop at just bringing the sheep to the good pasture and letting them eat and rest. It's the acknowledgement that there are ones that are injured and in need, ones that are weak and need to be made strong. But the sleek and strong, here's a big shift, but the sleek and strong I will destroy. That's troubling to me, but maybe there's an answer later on. But the sleek and the strong, I'm going to repeat it, I will destroy. Yet I will be the shepherd of the flock with justice. So that's going to address this bad thing we just heard. What is God's justice like? How does it operate? What is the goal of it? What does it seek to accomplish? Here ends the first section, beginning with verse 20. Therefore, this is what the Sovereign Lord says to them. This is not the shepherd speaking, the Sovereign Lord. See, I myself will judge. Not tend, not lead the sheep to pasture, not heal and bind up wounds, not rescue the stray. The verb changes. Let us pay attention. I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep, because you shove with flank and shoulder, butting all the weak sheep with your horns until you have driven them away. There's a you being talked about here, and we need to find out who's doing the bad stuff. We're going to find out. By the way, this is all very vivid for me, having grown up on a farm with a lot of sheep, 150 purebred Dorset sheep, and I, with the rams with horns, and I've witnessed the butting and the shoving about. I've witnessed ewes, the mothers, the ewes, who abandoned their young. I've witnessed mother sheep who adopt lambs that are forgotten and left out in the field to die. I've also helped to give birth to one, which was an interesting experience. I think I've told you about. I will, again, all this I language, those who shove and butt and injure. But I, this is the shift, but I will save my flock, and they will no longer be injured, they will no longer be plundered. I will judge, that verb again, I will judge between one sheep and another. So, which group of sheep are we in? If we are the sheep, God's flock, we get to answer that. Two more verses. God declares, I will place over them one shepherd, my servant David. So this is a big shift. This is now talking about the king language, the ruler over the people of Israel. And that's why this text is selected for Reign of Christ, Christ the King Sunday. I will place over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he will tend them, and he will tend them and be their shepherd. This is King David. I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David will be prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. So do you want to hear more? Okay. You know, from the printed title of the bulletin, this message is about shepherd of the good and bad. In no place in this text are there sheep that are banished outside the realm of the good pasture. The good and the bad are together. The good and the bad are tended. And God sets God's self up to do the deciding, it appears in this text, on who are the good sheep and who are the bad sheep. But God apparently has good eyes. I think God has eyes in the back of the head because God sees. God saw the bad stuff going on. The butting, the pride, the pushing about, the strong sheep, you know, going after the weak. God saw that. Is God talking about sheep here? God is talking about the rulers of Israel. The leaders who were the ones who were not being good shepherds. You want a king, you can have a king. And the Israelites had a succession of kings. But if you want a king, if you're going to be my people, your rulers have to act like shepherds. They have to be shepherds. These words in the 34th chapter of Ezekiel, you'd have to read chapters 1 through 33 to know the context. I'll just briefly allude to it. What has happened in the land of Israel? Jerusalem has fallen. The people have been scattered. They are exiles and refugees. Their homes and livelihoods have been destroyed. And the scripture is bold enough to say something to the effect that you got what you deserved. You're being punished, you rulers, you people, for the way you've acted, disregarded me, disregarded the needs of the people. Jerusalem has fallen, the temple is in ruins. And it would appear that the worst now lies in the background. And don't we all want those times in our lives when the bad and the worst is in the background and the pathway is opening up to the green pastures? So what does God do about this? The promise of these words from Ezekiel is that God begins the work of restoration. God does not wait for us. God offers hope. The first 32 chapters of Ezekiel were dominated, if you were to go home and read them. If you want a homework assignment, that's your homework assignment. You have time to read 32 chapters, right? Just don't fall asleep, okay? Well, okay. It's up to you. Dominating in these early chapters is words of judgment, chapter after chapter, and primarily against Judah. But the other nations, all the surrounding nations, are included as well. God's word of judgment is for all the nations, all the people. In until we get to chapter 33, and then leading into today's chapter, there's the transition into hope. Oracles of hope. And the promise of good to come. Did I say that the judgment had begun to fade and good things were starting to come? Yes, I did. That second part that I read, not for the leaders. That first part is the promise of God tending the sheep. The second part is talking, addressing the leaders who have not been good shepherds. I, the sovereign Lord, will be the good shepherd because you're not being good shepherds of the flock. And I care enough about my flock, verse 22, I will save my flock, and they will no longer be plundered. This word of judgment against the leaders of Israel sets up God's promise, to act as the true shepherd. I'm going to be the true shepherd, and I'm going to show you how to do it. And I'm expecting you to follow suit. We in the church, we the leaders, you the parishioners, all of us together have the opportunity to shepherd someone. We are the sheep. All of us are the sheep. But we are also shepherds. Somebody within the family, somebody within the community, someone we don't know, some people we know well, the young, the old, we can be the good shepherds. These words from Ezekiel chapter 34 show that God is the one who acts. God is the one who's taking the initiative. God is the one who's showing compassion. It makes me want to say thanks be to God for God showing the way, taking the initiative, and reminding us what we need to be doing always in our lives. God now promises to act as a shepherd. God will be the one who seeks out the exiles and bring them back. God will not wait for them to return on their own. But God will search and seek out. And all those words of what God will do, God will feed and nurture them. God will heal them. God will provide justice for them by confronting those who have failed them. For experiencing displacement, God will bring them back. And for their misery, God will nurture them and feed them. And for their hurt, God will heal them. Whatever neglect or mistreatment has been experienced, God will vindicate them. These words of comfort again come right on the heels of the announcement of the fall of Jerusalem. And by the way, historically, the restoration of Jerusalem did not happen for decades, decades upon decades, and we know that this is the reality of the many devastated communities and regions of our world, where there's a lot of bombing that has gone on and will perhaps continue to go on. All the devastated places, restoration that takes decades upon decades. But a reminder to us that God plunges into these circumstances. God plunges into the depths of our misery. Let that be a comfort to you. God plunges into our devastation and our weakness and seeks us out and feeds us and binds up our wounds. God restores and God renews. God breaks down our defenses, punctures our self-assurance of all the things, and I'm on the top of the list here, all the things I think I can do for myself, by myself, with no one else's help. Breaks down our defenses, punctures our self-assurance, rips away our arrogance. And so today we can reflect on those ways and those things that we need to experience God's restoration. In all the ways we need God to lead us to good green pastures, whether we're in a low place in life or the high places of life, the promise of green pasture even there. And so, for all in our society and world who are displaced, hurt, broken, abused, or betrayed, or when we are in that group, this passage speaks to us and indeed offers good news and hope. To displaced homemakers, to immigrants, to the unemployed, or even maybe to those who are simply homesick, to those who are fleeing from violence in South America and want a new beginning, all of these people in all these categories, this word from Ezekiel announces God's care and God's offer of healing. It's a clear and bold announcement to us that abuse and suffering are not a part of God's plan or God's will, nor is God's punishment for sin the ultimate reality. Always, always, always healing, restoration, and returning us all, the good and the bad, to the flock. God brings healing from the hurt of the world, this world that God has created. And this is how God in Christ reigns. Now, as God's people have the opportunity to celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion, we call it the Eucharist, which in Greek means thanksgiving. It's a celebration of thanksgiving. And I will focus on those words today. Let us now prepare to receive these gifts. receive hope. We come to receive strength to live in joy. So bless us now as we receive these gifts. Amen. And you may be seated. It is the Christ who was broken that comes to us in all the ways we are broken. And so it is in lifting up the bread of the evening meal that Jesus wanted to remind his disciples that that was the truth into which he was living. And perhaps Jesus was foreshadowing for them all the ways that their lives would become broken and poured out as they, in their own way, in their own time, lived a faithful life. And so we too lift up this bread in thanksgiving to receive strength from it, that God may provide healing within and to and toward all their brokenness. So Jesus lifted up the bread and indeed did break it and blessed it and gave it to them. And likewise, he took the cup of the evening meal and before them he passed it, reminding them that this was the essential part of he himself, his own lifeblood poured out. A reminder to them that he was going to go down, but he also came up again. It's a promise of resurrection. So when we drink this, maybe we may be reminded of the risen Christ as well. And so he blessed it and said, "Drink ye all of it, for ye show forth my death and life until I come again." And so now, ministering to you in the name of Jesus, we share with you the bread. We invite you to, as you come forward to the center aisle and come down and receive the bread, that you return to your seats with it, that we may all be partake together, and likewise with the cup as well. Let us receive the gifts of God for the people of God. Thank you. Let us this day and always take God's strength through the Christ into us, God's love, God's healing, God's restoration and hope. And let us drink deeply on this cup of salvation. As always, Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches. Cut off from me, you can do nothing. And so now, O God, bless these gifts to us, strengthen us, and keep us as yours. Amen. It is your presence in our tithes and our offerings that keep this ministry alive and vital, but most especially your presence and your gifts. Let us rise now as we offer our praise to God. Packaging is this Thursday at
1 o'clock.
1 o'clock, just a reminder, or all the other times if you're available. So, thank you. Anything else to emphasize? Yes, Angela.
The Advent breakfast is noted in the bulletin. When it says bring a dish, we are looking for fruits and dessert type items. The main dishes are mostly covered.
And I don't believe it made it in print this week, this Friday, December 1st, 7 o'clock, the Christmas tree lighting out of the factory, the tree in the front lawn. This Friday, December 1st, 7 o'clock. We are participating as a congregation. There will be some music. There will be a very, very brief message, and it will be a beautiful experience this Friday. 7 o'clock, December 1st, out of the factory. And you'll see the other things, and of course, in the bazaar on Saturday, 8 to 2. Yay.
1 o'clock this afternoon, if you are free, I would love to see you back here. We want to decorate the church for Advent and Christmas. So,
there's going to be a transformation here.
We hope.
We hope. The green will go, the white will go, the purple 17 and 24, which is Christmas Eve and also the fourth Sunday of Advent. Christmas Eve and fourth Sunday are not always the same, but it is this year. Anything else? Prayer requests. Bill Berkheimer, I meant to call LGH to see if he's still in the hospital. I have seen him this week. Plan to see him again today if he's still in. He had a seizure, and I was able to talk with him, and he actually laughed a little bit and got him joking a little bit. And but he's very weak, and he does need to be where he has been. So I'm trying to find that out and keep up with him as well. We know a number of our people are still out and away, you know, Thanksgiving time with families at a distance. Sue?
I have a joy.
Great, that's it. Reading.
Today is my son Steve's birthday.
Wow.
And we're very blessed and thankful that he's still here with us.
And that you can celebrate his birthday. Very good, wonderful. That is great. And Steve is back to work. Sue shared with me last week and up and about and good. And hopefully behaving, we'll see. Him, right?
Partly.
Partly. So now we know what to pray for. Very good. Anything else? Anything else? Continue our prayers for our pastor nominating committee, the PNC, as it works, as it does its studies, reflection, its discernment. It's a big, big task. We pray for them. Anything else? And we do know the community meal is coming up early, December the 14th, Thursday, December 14th. So that's around the corner as well. Okay. All good? Great. Let us pray. Oh God, I suppose we're never done praying for the luminous promises that radiate throughout today's passage in Ezekiel, but not devoid of a word of judgment. Your realignment, that is what judgment is all about. Realigning us, your people, the church, our communities, our neighborhoods, our nations, the world. And so in all the ways, that realignment and reconfiguration and restoration need to take place. That is going to be our ongoing prayer. But until that time, may there be shepherds that rise up to care for the weak, the suffering, those in pain, those in need, those without hope. We do pray for the fulfillment of the 23rd Psalm of leading to green pastures and rest beside still waters, even though we often walk through the valley of the shadow of death. We lift up this prayer to you today. Amen. Our concluding hymn.
Thank you.
God that is yours, who is a nurturing shepherd who wants to heal, rescue, and restore. Amen.